Welcome, Spin TV audience. Today we have a really special treat for you. We're going to do some live audio commentary for the final round of the Texas State's NT. I'm Jamie Thomas. I was behind the camera for this round, and with me is current reigning European champion Simon Lazat. Played really well this weekend, and he's going to give you guys some insight and just talk a little bit about how the round went and how tough it was to play in these conditions. So we're going to start off on hole one. Hole one's a 380-foot downhill, pretty basic hyzer for this top caliber of pro. You're going to see a guardian tree just off to the left of the basket that's about 320 feet away. Most of these guys are looking to get to the green, wouldn't you say, Simon?
Yeah, obviously, as you can see throughout the entire video, it was a very windy day out in Texas. So, but my first impression of the course was actually that hole. And I thought it was a pretty friendly starting hole since it's wide open and there's not a lot that can go wrong except for on the putting green as always. But it's a pretty basic hyzer for right-handed players. So all you really want to do is get it off to the right side and let it finish through the pin.
And we could see Ricky throws a more intermediate hyzer and he's going to leave himself a tester putt on the headwind side of the basket. The wind is pushing down towards the water today, which is opposite of how it's been. McBeth's going to take a little bit more of a wide route, and unfortunately it's not going to come back too much for him, and he's going to leave himself a pretty long putt there. Simon, what disc did you throw here, and what else were your thoughts?
So after I watched Paul throw a putter on that hole, which surprised me a lot, and he left it right and short, I thought I would grab my Firebird very overstable disc, throw it as far right as possible, because I knew the wind would bring it a lot to the left and it will skip and roll as it did. And I was very satisfied with that.
Got a great roll, looking, you know, pretty easy putt. Of course, you can't really say anything's too easy in this wind. And finally, we've got Paul Ulibarri on the tee, who's played very solid this weekend. He's gonna throw it out right as well. And, you know, very similar result to McBeth. He's gonna be a little bit deeper here, but still a tough tester putt to grab this birdie. Paul's going to step up. He's looking circle's edge. He's got about a left to right cross. Runs it just off the top. Tough putt for Paul. You know, he was sitting a few strokes back of Ricky. Ricky had a really big lead going into this, and everybody wanted to kind of take strokes early from him. As Ulibarri's putt goes a little bit low. And here's the tester putt, looking into a headwind. He's going to go just over it. And once you saw that, what were your thoughts on this? Did you ready to take a stroke from him right here?
My thoughts weren't to catch Ricky on the first hole. My thoughts were try to get on a consistent start for the round, because that putt was like a 15-footer in a pretty strong headwind, and that's a confidence boost right there to put that right in the middle.
Oh, did a great job. Took the only two on the card, and as we go to hole two, it's a 364-foot. It plays really natural to the righty hyzer. Again, the pin is down by the water, giving a little more precarious of a putt. The pros are going to look to park this hole as well on a big hyzer shot. What are your thoughts with the wind pushing towards the pin here?
So I actually had the honor to go first in this incredible group, which I made me kind of the wind dummy for that shot. The wind was pushing strong from right to left, so we all kept it wide and as low as possible because we knew it would skip, and the water is like 15 feet behind the pin, so keep it wide and make sure you get a chance at birdie.
Oh, the other days when the wind was pushing other directions, you're going to see a lot of the pros that are pushing over the first dead tree or maybe just even inside of it. But with the wind out there today, they did need to keep it wider and give themselves a look. So Ulibarri's going to get here, and unfortunately from this camera angle, it's kind of hard to see the landing, but everybody's going to give themselves at least a look for birdie. We've got Uli lining up. You can see the wind's going towards the water and he just cages it just a little bit short. Ricky here. A great putt, very solid into the chains. And then Simon's going to step up, looking at a death putt. How much did you think about that?
I thought a lot of that. I think, please just make this putt, because I wasn't going in that putt feeling really confident. The wind was blowing and just let go and saw right away, right in the middle. And then I knew I could get a good round going from then on.
It was a beautiful putt right to the heart of the chains, and McBeth pretty much parks it, nice tombstone right into the middle there for an easy birdie, and Uli's going to tap in for his three right here. Hole three is a little bit longer of a hole. The wind shifted a lot during the weekend here. It's 452 feet. We're going to shoot from the reverse angle, so we're going to see the drives coming at us. The big tree in the middle of the fairway is about 320 feet-ish in the fairway. You're looking for a birdie here, but today with the wind differently, how did you guys approach that?
I actually birdied this hole the first two rounds, but we had the exact opposite wind today. So I threw a Firebird low and as hard as I could, and I just passed the tree in the middle of the fairway, and I kept it safe. That was my main goal, so I was satisfied with that.
Ricky looks like he's lining up a much more aggressive shot. He puts more height on it here, but just hyzers out early. Luckily, he's going to catch the tree and drop, leave himself an upshot. And Paul sees this, and of course you think Paul's ready to get some strokes back on Ricky, so he really unleashes one. He's going to put it out and challenge the OB away from the water side and fade back in nicely, and a little bit far out from the pin, but definitely going to have a really good look there. And Ulibarri's going to put it, again, a little bit low, and it's going to fade in right here, right about where Simon and Ricky are playing from, leaving him a straddle forehand. So as he pushes this one out, you're going to see pops right over the water, and that may have just been a factor of the wind there, you know, maybe a little bit of nerves. He was getting off to a rough putting start. Ricky's going to put one right up by the pin, nice and easy. And then Simon's got a little bit of an unorthodox approach to the shot here.
Right, that's a Firebird jump putt, what do you call that? It was just so windy, you had to throw something super overstable, keep it low, and try to get it close, because any putt you want was going to be as short as possible.
Macbeth, then this is a big opportunity, but he kind of looked like he took a little 50-50 run there. Wasn't really sure he wanted to be aggressive, but he's going to take the three and live to fight another hole. As you can see, they're addressing where Uli's lie was, and that headwind just lifts it up, throws it right over, and, you know, still leaves about a 15-18 footer there afterwards. But chaining out, putting too high, probably thinking about the last couple holes where he caged it on the tailwind, and Simon will come in, tap in here. Ricky and Paul will take threes, and Uli's gonna unfortunately take a five on this one. Hole four is a really tough stretch of this course. We've got two par fours coming up, and with the wind playing the way it is, moving to the other side of the creek, it's gonna be pushing left to right. This hole is about 700 feet, and there's a big OB pond on the right side of the fairway that you need to throw at least 500 to clear. What are you thinking here, Simon, as you're going into this hole?
Well, I was again up to throw first, and we had a good wind for this one. It was slightly left to right and tailwind, so I thought I will just crush it out there and just flipped it a little much. And I didn't know till I walked up to my disc if I was actually safe or not. Fortunately for me, I was just in bounds, as you will see later.
Yeah, you can see you weren't quite happy with the result of that shot, but it sure did still have a lot of power on it. Ricky seemed to adjust off of what you did and just crushed it, threw it really high, letting it flex out and clears the out of bounds. What a great shot. And Paul's going to come up here. Looks like he's throwing a destroyer, his purple destroyer. Gets a little bit drifty on him. Same kind of result that happened to Simon's shot, and he will be smack dab in the middle of the creek. Uli's going to line up. He's going to take a little bit more of a straight run at it. Nice little hyzer, not quite as much left to right movement, but puts it, you know, dead center fairway, easy enough to look up and try to get up and down for that three. Paul's not very happy about going out of bounds here, lining up one of his trusty rock threes, and just puts it straight to the basket. This is just a great shot right here.
I was blown away by that. That was very impressive.
And we see good Simon's drive stays just in bounds, and I'm sure he has a big sigh of relief at that moment too.
Yeah, inside I was smiling. I just had a big smile on my face, and I knew I could get up and down for a birdie on that hole, which I parred the first two rounds. So
you left yourself a little bit wide on that hyzer forehand, a little bit of a tester putt. Uli's going to take the hyzer backhand approach and skids out. He's going to end up right by the tree behind the basket. Here's Ricky's shot, and just that's an absolute. That's just a great shot with the wind and with the pressure of the final round. You can't really play this hole much better than that. Lining up a nice little putter, going straight at it. Looking like a professional caliber shot right there if I've ever seen one. Uli gets one. He put a little bit of ante on that putt to counteract the right to left and slammed it right into the chains. Let me look at this wind with the flag pushing left to right on you.
Yeah. I knew all I had to do was just put it on the line and let the wind carry it to the basket, and that's exactly what I did.
It was a great shot. The putt looked so effortless, you know, slightly downhill, just slammed strong side. It was great. McBeth's gonna tap in after that awesome upshot. And we're gonna go into hole five. Another par four, even longer, 773 feet by the caddy book. You've got out of bounds, they squeeze the fairway down to the left side, so if you throw the hyzer, you gotta make sure it gets back in bounds, but not too far, because there's a slight downhill slope right to the road. What are your thoughts on this kind of drive?
My thoughts, like on every hole, was just keep it inside the ropes. And I left it a little left, but that's where I've been in practice every round, so I was comfortable with that.
And Ricky takes another one, he's throwing again that same purple, I believe it's a D1 that he's been throwing in the wind all day, and just puts it right down the fairway. Newly lines one up, and this is a nice little shot right here. Unfortunately, he's gonna get this little roll, and he's gonna put him right in front of that electrical box and give him a tough lie. So Paul's going last, and you don't want to give McBeast an opportunity to see what you've done and then outdo you, which is exactly what he does here. He takes a destroyer and just mashes it down the fairway, dead center, out driving everybody. It's a great shot. You see Uli here checking the wind. Throwing the hyzer, you know, this out of bounds is tricky because as you go towards the basket, it gets closer and closer, so you've got to make sure you keep it high enough to stay in bounds. And Simon's gonna line up yet another hyzer, try to keep it down out of the wind, give himself a look, goes past the basket. He's looking at a circle's edge with that one. And Ricky's gonna do the same thing, but he saws this one off a little bit and leaves it on the back side of the hill a little bit far. Leaving Paul, who takes a slightly different approach. Paul's gonna throw a straight shot right here into that wind, and he just throws the Nova right up to it, looking good. So when you see this putt, what are you thinking after this? You're about to line up and get a really good run and a birdie here.
Well, Ricky, you just watch the flag. That speaks for itself. It was super windy and so tough to putt. And that putt, I didn't line it up and was expecting really to make it. And it just was a little low, a little left, spit out. I wasn't frustrated about that at all.
That would have been a bonus for you then at that point, huh? Well, Uli's definitely a little more frustrated as he cages his second one low. Paul, pretty standard drop in right there. And man, this wind was just absolutely crazy. And the more the wind blows, the colder it is, and that makes it tougher on your hands, right?
Yeah, I had like five layers on, so it was chilly out there.
Hole six, this is the last one of the trio of really tough holes on the front side, measured 602 feet, slightly downhill. Another one of those fairways that's really squeezed down by the artificial OB, and we had a tailwind on this round, and what are you thinking there? That was different than the other days.
It really made this hole tempting to go for, because it's the longest, I think it's the longest par three on the course, and with this wind, it's definitely reachable for us, for all of us. And in practice, I've reached it every time I've cleared the OB at least. But you're lining up just wanting to throw it hard, throw it safe.
And just over torqued that one a little bit, got it up off, got it and just never came back in bounds for you. You can see you're not quite happy with that result there. And Ricky's gonna take a little more of a safe route like McBeth took. He's gonna try to clear the left side OB because it widens out down past, and he hits the post and he's no idea, waiting for the sign, and he barely stays in bounds there. And Uli goes for a similar shot, looking for a flex to get down into that widened out green area, gets caught in the last guardian tree and drops out of bounds. And man, he's taking some strokes today. You gotta give it to him. He kept his composure really well for the amount of strokes he took early in this round. And this is a great upshot right here. Just absolutely what you need to do to give yourself, to make up for that shot. And we'll see if Uli can do the same thing.
Yeah, I talked to Uli about exactly that first shot he just threw after the round, and it was a good drive. He would have easily cleared other B and just clipped the branches of the trees and landed OB. So a good shot actually cost him a big amount of strokes for that hole.
So Yuli's gonna look and take a provisional here. They're not sure if he's back in bounds or not, and he's gonna play it out safer to the left side. So Simon, talk a little bit about that. You know, if you go out of bounds on your drive and then on your shot, are you a little more cautious, and does that affect your confidence?
Yeah, I mean, he kind of knew he was throwing five, and he was still far away from the pin. So all he really wants to do at that point is finish the hole with the least amount of damage possible.
Definitely. And Paul with the safe drive, safe upshot. Knew he's going to run it here and get a little long, and it's just kind of piling on these first few holes for him. And that's a great putt in a tailwind right there. And looking slightly uphill, it's hard to see the undulation of the green, but he's definitely below the basket. It's at least shoulder height to him at that point. Looking up, and just with between the wind and the elevation on that basket, that just makes it one of those putts that you just think a little bit more about. Ricky here is going to tap in for his three after staying just in bounds on that. And Yuli's going to take an eight on that hole, an unfortunate eight. And Paul's going to take his three as well, and we're going to move on. So coming up here, we're starting at hole seven. You're looking to get more birdies on this stretch, right?
Yeah, especially in this wind. Like for the first four holes, we had like the headwind. That was a tough part. And for the next holes, we had the tailwind. And this hole is definitely for us distance throwers. We can easily reach that with a hyzer shot.
It is about 400 feet, marked 398 on the caddy book, and it the fairway kind of forms a reverse question mark. So it really gives you the opportunity with the right hand backhand to throw out two pin high and skip in. Even if you skip past the green, you're looking at a birdie putt. Paul's gets caught up in the tree and actually redirects out of bounds. So he gets the mark on the green, but he's putting for three. Ricky there throws a little bit long, but he's still gonna look. He's in bounds as the spotter tells him. Simon's gonna line up. The trusty PD2.
Yeah, exactly. I thrown that hole a bunch of times in practice, and I was long every time, so I told myself, leave it short, it will carry there, and that's exactly what it did.
It did indeed, and he's going to look at a nice birdie look, and Uli's going to take a little more of a hyzer route. It flattens out a little bit on him, gets long of the guardian tree, and he's going to stay in bounds right down by where Ricky was. So I believe it'll be Uli's going to be out first, and this is not an easy run right here. There's no flag on the basket, but the wind's definitely still up. Ricky with a similar shot, and that's just gorgeous. That's a great little floater putt. You don't expect to get that, and that's tough to come back from when your opponent hits a huge putt like that.
Paul, I was very impressed by Ricky's putt right there, and just watching Paul right now, I kind of knew he would make that because he wasn't taking a bogey on that hill, leaving Ricky with two strokes for him. So
I think everybody in the gallery could see that Paul really focused up on that hole, and he's going to start, you know, trying to make a run right at these. And then Simon's going to line up for a birdie and gets the spit out. Two spit outs in three holes. How did you feel about that one right there?
That was kind of a heartbreak because I was putting well, I was confident, and that wasn't a long putt. It was at like 15 feet max and just cut right through the chains. I was a little frustrated after that, but that happens. It was my first spit out for the tournament, so it's all right.
You putted solid all weekend. You know, it's bound to happen sooner or later. But we've got some more opportunities for birdies coming up. So hole eight, we're looking at 350 feet. It's uphill. You've got a little bit of a guardian bush on the right side if you're throwing the hyzer. But overall, you're really looking to birdie this hole.
Yeah, this one is for sure a should birdie for any top player out there. Wide open, little uphill. It's not that long, as we just talked about.
And you're looking, you see Ricky goes with the forehand approach. Paul goes with the kind of medium hyzer, throwing, you know, more or less straight at it with a slightly overstable disc, and it just kind of fades out on him at that point. The pros here, very interestingly, all take kind of different routes on this. Simon, you're going for a little more of a spike.
Yeah, because that was the shot I've practiced on. The wind was blowing from right to left from the tee, so I left it wide. That's a pretty good result right there.
Definitely within your range to make. And Yuli's going to... looks like he gets stalled out just a little bit. He probably didn't mean to leave it quite that high. And so the furthest out is going to be Macbeth. And he's looking... it looks like it's circle's edge or just outside. And he just floats it in that left-to-right wind. And that's a world champ caliber putt right there. And Uli leaves it short once again. It looked like the wind kind of switched on him there. You see the flag blow in the opposite direction. Simon's lining up a putt. How bad do you want this birdie after that last spit out?
The funny thing about that putt was it was a lot worse than the putt I just didn't get on the hole before. And it stuck. So I was feeling good on the putting green that day. I couldn't say anything else.
Yeah, and you know, you see Ricky grab one right there. And you can't really let him get too far ahead. He came into this round with a huge lead. And you just really got to grab all the opportunities you can. And speaking of opportunities, hole 9, you're looking at 264 feet. It's slightly downhill. You can only see the top part of the basket from the tee, but you're looking at a pretty basic shot. You know, this is a basic shot for these guys. They're going to be throwing putters or maybe a mid-range in this wind. Tell us about what you threw and what your thoughts were.
Yeah, this hole is one of the shortest holes on the course, and it should be the must birdie hole for sure. But I threw a MD3, it's an overstable mid-range from Discmania, and I just left it a little right side, clipped branches, and left it short.
And you can see two others are within putting distance. Paul got definitely flashed the rings on that one. I'm going to borrow a phrase from some other great disc golf video commentary there. So you laid this one up. Tell me about this tactical move.
Oh, I just didn't want Macbeth to get like two strokes on one hole on me because he was parked, and so I wanted to get away with the three. It was a downhill shot, so I just laid it up.
And he, luckily enough for you, Ricky missed, in a rare occasion, missed a putt that's totally makeable, so you're not going to lose any strokes on the leader. And Paul's going to take his two right there. And you're going to move on to another hole, which you really want to get. A lot of pros are throwing the forehand on this. Tell me a little bit about that decision.
I mean, the basket is guarded by smaller trees all along the right side. The hyzer is definitely a shot, but if you leave it a little short, you will hit trees. If you leave it long, you will go past the basket. So the sidearm just seems like the more consistent shot on that hole.
And we have Paul, who steps up and, as we're talking about, takes a overstable disc right here, sidearm, and actually hits the underside of the cage, rolls out, and that's a great little bit of agility by the cameraman there to not interfere with the flight of the disc. Once again, we got another sidearm from Yuli. It's going to come in just a little bit hot. Another ace run. Both these guys, you know, it looked like they needed to get these strokes back on, Simon and then Ricky, so going for the aggressive line. And Ricky, this roll is just ridiculous. You know, sometimes it's just your weekend and all the right things are happening. That roll is fantastic. Leaves him with a pretty easy putt right there. And Simon with the PD2 once again. Throws it a little wider than the other guys and is rewarded with a nice CTP shot there. Nice drop in. It's nice to have those drop ins, especially in this wind. Paul's going to line up with a little headwind putt. He's a circle's edge at this point, and this is by no means an easy run. He's going to leave it just a little bit high, but definitely within his range to make that comeback. Yuli's going to line up, and at this point, Yuli really needs this putt, and unfortunately, he's just going to cage it. Again, it was a tough putting day, but, you know, as I said before, you got to give it to him. You know, as many times as the break didn't go his way, he really never broke down. You never really saw him get too upset, and you know, he handled himself like a true professional out there, so definitely kudos on that. Ricky with another drop in, or a little bit more then, and Paul's got to make this one here for a three, and then Simon with the absolute drop in on the CTP.
Easy birdie.
Hole 10A, it's 468 feet, and it's a hole that I personally watched you park multiple times in practice on a variety of different routes. From the video angle though, you're not going to be able to see what's so tricky about this hole, so let us know what makes this hole so difficult.
Yeah, like all the holes on this course, this hole is defined by OB lines on the right side and the road on the left side of the basket. And especially tricky from the tee, you see all these trees and you have to go kind of low hyzer or low straight. It's not the easiest shot in the world, but I did just what I did. Just what I wanted to do, and left it right in the middle of the fairway.
In a stiff headwind, he kept it on hyzer and let it fade in. Unfortunately, the same fate is not going to happen to Paul, as you know, the headwind just keeps pushing it out, and he gets a little bit of a short skip on it, not what he was looking for there, and he's going to have a really tough mark throwing three. And just like all the guys are doing today with this wind, he's going to throw it low hyzer, keep it in the fairway, and you know, try to get a three up and down. So Paul lines up, as you can see, he's probably only 50, 60 feet off the tee pad. And, you know, he doesn't want to lose strokes here. He really needs to get up and down from this point. He's going to challenge the OB line again on the hyzer. As you can see from the camera angle, the underside of the disc is just a little bit exposed, and you can't do that in a headwind. So, you know, they're going to talk here about the mark. Curious. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about what he was saying.
Yeah, Paul was asking if we think if you've ever crossed the OB line a little further down the fairway, and we all agreed that we think it went OB all the way, so he basically re-threw.
So he's got to pull out another disc, and in a similar situation to the one Ulibarri was in earlier this round, he really needs to try to get up and down from this point. But in world champ fashion, you can't keep him down for too long. He's going to throw a nice hyzer. Goes a little bit long of the pin, but you know, it's better to get that mark and at least have a run at it from the tailwind side of the basket. Yuli's going to keep it on hyzer again in this wind. You can see the wind shifting a little bit and actually pushing towards that artificial OB, which makes it tricky to land your disc to penetrate into that wind.
Yeah, I made the mistake to keep it a little too tight to that tree and skip it left to the basket.
Was that a position where you were looking at the wind and the flag and just underestimated it?
Yes, and especially looking at the OB on the right side, just desperately trying to keep it in bounds.
So Paul lines up, he definitely has a tester, he's on the tailwind side, he leaves it just too wide and chains out, and he's not happy about that putt. And Yuli here, nice little Annie, and he looks like he didn't even expect to make that.
No, it was the first make for him in that round.
But anything, any way you can get it going, you get it going. Nice, strong, heart of the chains putt right there in the crosswind to get your three and walk to the next hole. And you see Paul and Ricky clean up here and trying to make leeway into Ricky's lead, but he just played really tough all day today. Keep watching Spin TV, guys. We're going to post the second half of this round and bring Simon back and get some more thoughts on his round. So until then, I'm Jamie Thomas, and for Simon Lazat, keep watching Spin TV.